Hello, Earthlings, and welcome to the Goob Show. Hit the like button on your way in and subscribe to the channel. Now relax and enjoy the show. As Goob always says, look up. You may even see me coming. Now let's get into this shit show.
Desert and the great American Southwest. I bid you all good evening, good morning, good afternoon, whatever the case may be, wherever you are. All the time zones around the world covered like a blanket by this program, Midnight in the Desert. I'm Art Bell. And there are only two rules for this radio program. No bad language, don't need it, and only one call per show. Other than that, no rules. I would like to officially welcome KFRH Radio, 100 kilowatts in Las Vegas, at 104.3. Now, 100 kilowatts on a 9,000-foot mountain, let me tell you, really goes and goes and goes. It covers parts of four states. And also KBET, their sister, 790 AM in Las Vegas. Now, let me tell you a story, all right? It's a story of internet woes and a guy who worries way too much. That would be me. Last night, beginning at 8:36 p.m., now at 8:36 p.m., I come over here about 8 o'clock, and it's here in my guest house. That's where I've got the studio, by the way. And I start getting ready for the program. You know, I look around at what's new, what's going on. And, it was at 8:36 p.m. the internet died. Now, I'm not going to go into details, because I don't want to encourage any trouble, but, they came, the internet company, at about 5 o'clock this afternoon, and of course, there was no internet in here at all, so they went out to a box that is located outside somewhere, and they found a wire ripped off and shorted to another wire. Now, I'm not saying somebody yanked on it, but it's entirely possible. And so they put it back, but there's something else going on. So if I begin to sound blippy or unusual to you, that will mean it's not completely fixed. So, yeah, I mean, somebody could have yanked on it, or I suppose, it's only a few months old, I suppose, you know, the warming sun and the cooling could have done something, but it wasn't exactly like that. So, at 8:36, I realized, guess what? I don't have any internet. Well, I use internet for my phones to get the signal from here to there and then to you. I mean, it's all internet, right? And then, of course, the computers, Skype, whatever, it's all internet. Every last little bit of it, we are in that age, the internet age. So last night was, you know, I want to say beyond miserable for me, if you can imagine. My daughter, poor Asia, has hand, mouth, and foot virus. It's like an outbreak in her school. And the two little girls next door also are down with it, and it is miserable for a child, and I guess really horrible for an adult, so I'm trying really hard not to get it. But, I mean, last night was just bad, because here I was off the air, which I don't like being. I wanted to be here, of course. And so I was miserable about being off the air and wondering what the heck happened. And then on top of that, poor Asia's down. I'm feeling really poorly about her. My wife is the main caregiver for Asia right now, so that I don't get this. Rarely do adults get it, but they can. So, no kisses and hugs in the house. Let's see. Off the air, wire yanked. No kisses, no hugs. But I'm up anyway, because my body clock says, Art, you will be on the air. And you will do the program between 9 and midnight, and then you will probably not go to sleep for 3 or 4 hours after that. So, it was a miserable night last night, and I hope it's fixed, but, you know, with the internet, who knows? Now, the good news is, and I was going to come on last night, and I was going to joke. I was going to joke with you, and I was going to say, sadly, this may be my last program. Because here in this time zone, we've still got 2 hours to be hit by the asteroid, the internet predicted, right? Told you it was ridiculous, but they predicted it. And guess what? I have heard that since we did not get wiped out last night, these guys on the internet and gals have moved the date to the 28th. So Earth is not going to be now smashed until the 28th. They have to keep setting new dates. Okay, so what else is new? The Pope plunged into the middle of New York. And boy, that is a melting pot in New York, isn't it? And I worried every second. I don't know about you, but the Pope in New York, the Pope even in Washington is bad enough, but in New York, among those crowds, it's just scary, and I worried for him every moment. A duck boat tour vehicle and a charter bus carrying foreign students to a college orientation event collided on a busy Seattle bridge on Thursday. 4 people dead. Dozens went to the hospital. Bad. Bad. Just awful. President of Mexico told families of 43 students who disappeared a year ago. You know about this, right? In southern Mexico, during a meeting on Thursday, that he would create a special new prosecutor and try to find out what has happened to all of these children. And now this. I think I have found something on Mars before Richard. Could that possibly be true? Well, all right. Probably not. Probably he knows. And I'm just on the air first. If not, then I want you to know. I want you to go to artbell.com because on Mars right now, somebody actually has found what looks like Stonehenge on Mars. I wouldn't kid you, and I wouldn't put it up if it didn't look spectacular and, I should use words like torsion field and physics, and there is a kind of physics too, concentric circles. Look at these rocks. This is virtually Stonehenge on Mars. So if you want to see it for yourself, it's at artbell.com. I'm sure Richard will be all over this when he gets to air tonight. Awesome. Absolutely awesome. And I don't really see how it could be. And you take a look at the photograph and you let me know what you think. All right. So coming up next is one of my favorite people in all the world. He is Dr. Jacobs. Dr. David Jacobs, professor, actually. And the reason that I find him so fascinating is that unlike everybody else nearly in the world that I would interview, the professor does not necessarily feel that the aliens that most of us think are visiting us are good guys. You may remember this from years past. Dr. Michael Jacobs is a retired professor of history at Temple University in Philadelphia. He also has been a UFO researcher since 1966. Long time, right? In 73, he completed his doctoral dissertation in the field of intellectual history at the University of Wisconsin-Madison on the controversy over unidentified flying objects in America. This was only the second PhD degree granted with a dissertation involving a UFO-related theme, so it's very rare. He has written and delivered many articles, papers, and addresses on the subject of UFOs and abductions. He's been a consultant to the major UFO organizations from 1977 to 2011. He taught the country's only regular curriculum university course on UFOs and abductions. UFOs and American Society. Pretty cool title, huh? UFOs and American Society. Since the early 1980s, he has specialized in the UFO abduction phenomenon. He has investigated, in fact, over 1,150 abductions with 150 different individuals. So coming up in a moment, Dr. David Jacobs. And we're going to hope the ones and zeros stay in place tonight. I'm Art Bell. This song is dedicated to me, by the way.
Conductor Art Bell will punch your ticket when you call 1-952. Call Art. That's 1-952-225-5278.
All right, everybody. We're monitoring the situation with the Internet, and it may or may not be okay. So having said that, I'm going to introduce you to Dr. Jacobs. Professor Jacobs, welcome to the program, Professor.
Thank you, Art. I appreciate it.
Good to have you. And the reason I have always... How long has it been since we talked, anyway?
Oh, hours and hours ago.
Yeah, more like a decade or something.
Something like that, yeah.
A long time.
Hours.
And the reason that I have always enjoyed you so much is because I have always said that these things, these creatures, these entities, whatever they are, coming to Earth... are, in my opinion, not at all necessarily our friends. And I know that you have, in fact, written a book on that subject and that you probably agree with that. And you're about the only one, frankly. Everybody else thinks it's kumbaya time and they come down to advise us every now and then on our poor ecological maintenance of the planet.
Yeah, to me, it's just... Well, it's unfortunate. I just never get that. I never have gotten it. And even Bud Hopkins didn't get that. He might have gotten it a couple of times, but the majority of the times he never got that. And it's all a matter of the agenda that one has going into the session. It's all a matter of the questions that are asked and the ability for the person who's doing the questioning to analyze what those questions mean as opposed to just accepting them at face value. And it's really a struggle for me because I come across this all the time, and I just know it doesn't make any logical sense whatsoever. It makes no sense in terms of what people tell me.
Well, I don't know how many legitimate cases of abduction and messaging do you think there have been? I interviewed Travis Walton not long ago. That's a very well-witnessed case.
Good case.
A good case, but he doesn't remember much. They didn't have much of a message for him.
He only remembered about 20 minutes of a 5-day event, and he didn't undergo hypnosis to find out really what happened.
That's right. So, how many cases have you studied, Doctor, in which, you know, there has been a substantial message given and that you feel the case is pretty good?
None. There's no such thing as a message, in my opinion. People don't come from a trillion zillion miles away to give somebody a message that they will immediately forget, because that's what the abduction phenomenon is all about. Logically, the message concept came from the contactees of the 1950s who basically were charlatans. The major ones, George Adamski and Truman Bethroom and people who the audience probably never heard of. But they were all the rage in the 1950s, and they got on flying saucers and they took trips to the various planets. One guy, Howard Menger, took a trip to the moon. He got out on the moon's surface. The air there was just like the air you and I breathe. He had dinner with the king of the moon, you know. And other ones go to Venus, and it's wonderful, and it's great. It's a paradise on Venus, so sort of forgetting to talk about the fact that it's 800 degrees on Venus. And they were always left with a message. And the message was, you know, we come in peace, it's great, and we all have to get together and stop atomic bombs and kill communists.
Now, that might be one area where you're making a point that needs to be contested. We did have UFOs over missile silos, and they actually turned off the ability to launch. Pretty good evidence of that. And then the Russians had a very similar incident. And other than that, you're right. But, I mean, those two are standouts.
Yeah, well, those aren't necessarily messages. We don't know what happened there. It could be that their very presence in some way screwed up the electronics, like car stoppages, which for UFO sighters is just, you know, there's been thousands of those. People say that their car will slow down and stop, and after when they see one of the UFOs in its proximity.
Yeah, but they weren't hovering over high emission Volkswagen factories. They were hovering over ICBMs.
Right. But still, we can extrapolate that as a message because it. But there's still so many other things it could be that. The message just fits into one of many. For the messages of today, generally speaking, the messages that people have, I've read about, you know, that they're personal messages to the person that deals with the problems of the earth, ecology,
yes,
and
that's right.
Climate and things like that, all sort of current stuff. And it's not a concept in the UFO abduction phenomenon. It's nonsensical. You have to understand that the abduction phenomenon begins in infancy and goes with great frequency all the way into old age. It stops somewhere in old age. We're not sure when, but so people have hundreds and hundreds, and I know that sounds crazy, hundreds of abduction events. Almost all abductees have that number of abduction events. And the concept of the message just is not there. The setup is not for a message. The people are not special to be able to carry forth a message. Now, you do get people who say they have messages. A lot of these people, I'm not going to name any names, but let's just say I'm extremely dubious of their accounts.
Okay, I'm going to back up a little bit and actually ask you, I think, if you believe that these people who claim they were abducted, in at least some cases, actually were.
Oh, people who claim they were abducted actually were?
Yes, yes.
Yes. You have to remember that the people I see fill out a questionnaire for me, talk to me for a couple of hours, and have all sorts of other contacting and messaging, so to speak, with me before I let them into my office. So I know by the time they walk into my office, I know for the most part, there's a couple of exceptions in my life, but for the most part, I know that these people are serious people who might be psychiatrists, psychologists, university professors, PhDs, MDs, LLDs, or people who dropped out of school in the 12th grade.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody in between. But it doesn't matter because they all say the same thing. They all have the same experiences. It's all been going on all their lives. And generally speaking, their mother or their father was an abductee beforehand. And their grandmother or grandfather on one side or the other was an abductee. And so this is a phenomenon that goes back probably to the latter part of the 19th century. You can date it back with a degree of certainty to 1917 and with a lot of certainty to the 1920s. But when you have a person who's abducted 400 times, which sounds insane.
It does.
But is actually not unusual at all. they're not going to give this person a message. They got other things that this person has been doing for them all their lives.
All right, but let's stop there. So you do believe, certainly, in the abduction phenomenon. No question about that. I wanted to establish that. In almost every case, when there is a message given, as I pointed out, it's the, you're ruining Earth, you need to, you know, reestablish yourself with Earth, and you need to clean things up, and the planet's going to die, and it's almost always that, isn't it?
That's au courant. That's new stuff. They didn't say that in the 40s and 50s.
Well, we didn't think about things like that in the 40s and 50s.
No, they thought about nuclear war in those days.
So that's right.
Most of the messages that the charlatans came forward with were nuclear stuff and communism and all that sort of stuff. It's culture dependent. Here's the situation. When a person is first abducted, let's just say in childhood, or maybe even in infancy, they're abducted not once. They're abducted, you know, let's just say 5 times a year. I have never, ever worked with a person who is only abducted 5 times a year. That is a fantasy. But let's just say that it's 5 times a year. Most abductees will give their right arm for 5 times a year only. Now they're 40 years old. That's 200 abductions.
That's right.
If it's 10 times a year, which is ridiculously small number of abductions from what people tell me, it goes on over and over and over again, that's 400.
Yeah.
Having 400 abductions a year means nothing to me. It's standard stuff. Same thing with abductees who are real abductees. You know, they know they've been abducted throughout the course of their lives. They only may remember maybe 20 events or maybe 30. I have one woman who I worked with, but I worked with on a daily basis almost, who we talked about 100 different events that had happened to her, but she was being abducted a couple of times a week. All these people want it to stop. All these people don't like it. They want to get rid of it.
Professor, I've got to say, if I was being abducted 400 times a year, in a lifetime, 400 times, I'm not sure I could maintain my sanity, which probably is in doubt when you claim abduction anyway. I'm actually not putting that.
They don't remember any of them. And the ones that I see or other serious researchers see are the people who have bleed through memories and remember some events happening to them and don't know what those events were. And they want to find out. They've been thinking about it for years and they just need to find out what happened that time when they were driving along the highway and they were in one spot and then it was 2 hours later and they were in the same spot. And they think about that, and they think about that, and they want to clear it out, they want to find out. Generally speaking, with the questionnaire I have on my website, they've undergone a whole lot of other things that they don't attach to abductions. But abductees answer these kinds of questions in huge percentages, and non-abductees usually just say no. And so it's a clandestine phenomenon, and when you're secretive, the first thing that you have to do to maintain secrecy is prevent the person who's being abducted from remembering it. That's why it's so difficult to do, and why you have to have hypnosis, and why more people aren't coming forward, although there's thousands and thousands and thousands have already come forward. So getting a message and remembering the message, it makes no sense.
Well, all right, then I'm taking it that you generally put a person under hypnosis, and that's the only way they remember what happened, right?
Sometimes people remember what happens in a single event. They don't remember other events, but they remember one thing. And they consciously remember what happened to them. Now, here's another problem. And my next book is going to be How to Do Hypnosis with Abductees, because it's a tangled mystery. When they consciously remember the events that took place during their abduction, which might have been 5 years ago, might have been last night, whatever it is, they're notoriously inaccurate. most people think, well, if a person remembers it just straight out, it's got to be real, it's got to be accurate, they've got to know it and all that. And the answer is no, that is not what experience tells us. It's notoriously inaccurate.
But even under hypnosis, you're saying it's notoriously...
No. This is just conscious
memory. Oh, I see. Okay. And so, under hypnosis, how would you qualify the percentage of accuracy relayed to you?
The first session, I'd say 60% accurate, 40% not so accurate. Second session, 70-30. Third session, maybe 80-20. By the time you get to the fourth session, you're in the 90th and above percentile. As people get used to it, because the questioning that I use, anyway, is just straight chronological and logical.
All right. But does it become so chronological that as you go through the series of hypnotic sessions with them, they build on their own story?
No. We do a different session, a different event each session. Unless we left off in the middle of one for some reason or other, we'll continue on with that one until the end. But I try to do a different event each time. And the one that they consciously remember, which might have happened 20 years ago, for example, that's an important one for their life because they've been thinking about that for 20 years. So I don't like to do it until the fourth or fifth session when they get used to the remembering process, they get used to being relaxed and focused, and then I do that session.
All right. Hold on, Professor. Hold it right there. We'll be back.
We don't need no education.
In that darkest time between dusk and dawn, from the high desert, it's Art Bell's Midnight in the Desert. Now, here's Art.
Professor David Jacobs is my guest, and he's a very unique individual. He's the only one I know that kind of agrees with me that these are not necessarily good guys. And for a moment there, I thought that he was about to tell me that abductions don't actually happen. But that's not the case at all. In fact, he very much confirms the fact that they happen again and again and again to certain individuals. So we're going to discuss the nature of them a little bit. So, Doctor, when you get these people under hypnosis, what typically, if there is a typical, what typically do you find out?
Well, basically, they all say the same thing in terms of procedures that are done to them. We used to concentrate on table procedures. They're put on a table. They are under control. They can't run. They can't scream. They can't swing. They can't kick.
Right.
They just, besides that, it's been going on all their lives, and they know the routine. They're close removed in an ante room if it's a large UFO, or just if it's a small UFO, just in the one room that they have. And they're placed on a table, and sperm is taken from men, eggs are taken from women. There is a touching process, which appears to be some sort of an examination of the person's body, but the examination, in my opinion, is a neurological examination. It's looking through the sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve endings and all that, and the neurological system there. The neural system, I should say. And that's my best guess, but I've just heard hundreds and hundreds of these things, and I always wondered what they were doing, and that's my best guess.
And it usually involves sperm and eggs, with the respective sexes.
We've known this since the very, very beginning of our knowledge of abductions. In the Antonio Vias Boas case in Brazil of 1957, the guy who was abducted said that he was forced to have sexual intercourse with a human-looking female He couldn't control himself. He just had to do that. And then she allegedly, and I'm not sure of this, but she allegedly pointed to her body and then pointed up. And he said that he felt like he was being used as a stallion to improve their stock. And the odd thing about that sentence in 1957 was that there's a certain prescience to it. I mean, it does figure into the reproductive program that they have. Then in the next one that we heard about, which was in 1961, the Barney and Betty Hill case, they took sperm from Barney, who found it to be such an embarrassing event that when John Fuller wrote the book Interrupted Journey about their experiences, he had Fuller take that part out of the book, which was actually a gift to humanity, because nobody could then claim that other guys who said they were taking a sperm from me, they just picked it up from the Barney and Betty Hill story. They couldn't say that.
Well, if you look at, for example, Whitley Strieber, something very embarrassing happened there as well. And Whitley is such an honest, straightforward guy that he talks about it. And it's not easy for him, Dr. Jacobs. Not easy at all. He's very emotional, very about it, very upset about it. But he tells the truth, and he takes a lot of heat. A lot of heat.
Well, but for Barney Hill, the Barney Hill story was Betty and Barney made into a movie in 1975, a TV movie, and a best-selling, of course, Willie's book, Communion, was a best-selling book, too.
That's right.
But before Whitley, nobody could blame it on Barney in terms of their memories were confused because they saw the TV movie or whatever it was. You know, it just wasn't there.
I see.
And with Betty Hill, they stuck a needle in her navel, and she said that they told her that it was a pregnancy test. Now, in my estimation, that was confabulation, and they probably did not say that because it still remains a unique sentence that they had that no other abductee has ever said. However, the procedure of sticking a needle in a woman's navel is extremely common. And my best guess is, and Bud Hopkins' best guess was also at the time, is that they're angling the needle towards the ovary and just pulling out follicles from the ovary that way. So we knew that it had this reproductive aspect very, very early on, and it still has it, even now, even as we speak. They're just not letting up on that. And that's important.
I think it's potentially very important because, of course, we're looking toward motive on their part. And one can imagine any number of things that they're trying to perhaps refresh their own genetic pool that might be getting somehow stale, if genetics can get stale. Or they might be trying to reproduce some sort of hybrid or something, or they might be checking on us because they originally designed us.
Well, I'm going to go for number two. That's my answer. The thing is that fetuses are then, after a while, are inserted into women's uteruses and in other parts of their body there. And then they're removed after about 9 or 11 weeks when the woman begins to sort of show, or even earlier if they're put in a slightly different position. And then abductees see babies floating or fetuses floating in nutrient tanks. Then eventually they see them as babies. And they have to hold the babies, and they see them as toddlers. They have to play with the toddlers and deal with the toddlers. They see them as young children. The same thing applies there, playing with them. They see them as older children. They see them as adults, as adolescents. They see them as young adults. They see them as adults, and they don't see them as older adults.
So
now, they have to be older adults by that time themselves, obviously, but they don't describe them as like being a 70-year-old hybrid.
Right.
Then there's the between humans and aliens. But there is a gradation. Some look quite alien, some look quite human.
Well, that's the way it works out. I mean, if you mix a Chinese a woman and an American male, sometimes you get very Chinese-looking children. In fact, more often than not, frankly, they have very strong genes. And then sometimes more American. So that's kind of normal, right?
Well, you would think. However, in recent years, what we have seen is, in my second book on the subject called The Threat, which came out in 1998, I talked about hybrids quite a bit. And what the gray aliens would say from time to time is that soon there was going to be a change. Soon everyone was going to be happy. Soon everybody would know his place. And it was going to be wonderful. It was going to be great. And the change was coming soon. And I knew that soon in some way meant an introduction into the society by human-looking hybrids. I tried to get the abductees to tell me what soon meant. You know, did it mean a million years? Did it mean 5 million years? Did it mean tomorrow?
May I stop you for a moment?
Yes.
Originally you said that they're not really giving us messages.
Correct.
And yet this would appear to be a message.
Well, it's not a message telling us to do anything or that there's something about the Earth.
Right.
That's what most messages are these days. They're giving them the chemical analysis, how to do a chemical analysis of some bizarre something or other, or physical or astronomical. This is just soon we're all going to be together, you know.
Okay.
And a lot of abductees have reported this. But you can't really take it as a message. It's just something that is said. But we never knew what soon meant. Well, in the book that I just published a couple of weeks ago, Walking Among Us, I think that the change, that we're in the change now, and it started in when I first, I don't know when it started, but I first started hearing accounts starting in 2003 that I had never heard before. Now, I've looked at 1,150 different incidents with people.
Right.
And most of them are pretty much the same. In fact, I sit on a chair and there's a little day couch or day bed in my off my office here in my home office, and I will ask these questions and well, what's happening next and what do they do next, and they're talking to me and talking to me and talking to me, and I'm listening really really hard, and I'm really listening hard.
Sure.
And I realize I'm listening so hard I'm dreaming. I have fallen asleep. I've heard these stories hundreds of times. It's soporific. And people have asked me, are you asleep?
Uh-huh.
And I say, oh, no, not me. Oh, not me. No, no. What happens next? You know, and oh, God.
All right, so it is your contention that these hybrids now walk among us.
Right. Well, the point is that soporific aspect of these of the accounts is extremely important, because everybody, no matter who they are, oh gosh, I'm going to have to.
I hear it. You're getting a phone call, right?
Okay, I don't know, unknown name and an unknown number, and I'm going to pull this thing out. 1 o'clock in the morning, almost. Somebody's calling.
Yes.
You have to have that constant sense of people having the same experiences over and over and over again, no matter who they are. That's very important because it validates everybody. In 2003, I began to hear something I never heard before.
And that
that's
was
unusual. And what it was a guy who I had talked with. I had 4 sessions with him, I think it was. His name was Bernard. And he told me that he had just remembered that he had a friend. And this was a really good friend of his named Eric. And Eric was a great friend of his. It was his best friend. And, you know, he just never remembered him before. But yeah, Eric, yeah. And he didn't know what Eric's last name was. And he didn't know where Eric was from, or whether he was married, or whether he worked, or anything like that. But he'd known Eric, and Eric was really a good friend of his. And so, which, of course, makes no sense whatsoever. It's senseless. You can't have your best friend and not know his last name.
Right.
So we did a session on that, and we did various sessions. He got on fishing trips with this guy. They've been to restaurants. They've been visiting here and there. They've been in other countries together. This is not evidence. All these accounts from Bernard are not evidence unless somebody else begins to say the same thing without knowing about what Bernard was saying. And then somebody else did fairly quickly.
Really?
Then another person did, then another person, then another person, then another person, then another person, then another person.
Wow.
And I realized one person I worked with since 1993, I'd worked with for 10 years, and one person I worked with since 1987. And they began to tell me these stories about going places with hybrids and teaching them how to dress and this and that. And I knew this was the change. It was on us now. This is it.
Okay. A number of questions popped to mind. For example, if you were staring at a hybrid, would you know it?
No, you would not know it. And if you knew it, that person wouldn't be there.
Well, then that would suggest a more subtle merging of the species, if you want to put it that way, because they certainly look more human than they do anything else, right?
I call them hybrids. They are bred to look human, and not just human, but average human that will not stand out, that blends in, period. If they're too tall, not a chance of coming down here. If they got too big a nose, not going to happen. If their eyes are too big, nope. They have to look absolutely average.
Normal.
Now, here's the thing. All gray aliens and all hybrids and all hybrids and all other beings on board the object have one interesting trait. They can control people's minds neurologically and make them do or think or see anything that they want them to do or see or think or see. And we can't do that to them. That is an astoundingly huge difference.
It is.
It's a difference between species. It makes us a second-class species and them a first-class species. It's not like they're just kissing cousins who live off in somewhere else and they're coming to visit us and all the rest of that stuff. That's not what this is about. You got to remember, this is a global phenomenon. This goes around the world. It does not matter where a person is born or what their life was like or what their educational level is or what their intelligence level is or their geographic area or anything. They all say the same thing in terms of the abduction phenomenon.
These are remarkable, remarkable allegations you're making. Now, I've got a zillion questions. Hybrids. Okay, we'll call them that, hybrids. Humans with the ability to control others' minds, are they aware of that ability?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, because they rely on abductees to teach them how to live in society. They rely on them on board the object when they're young, and when they get ready to move into apartments, they rely on them to teach them how to furnish the apartment, to teach them how to go shopping, to teach them how to drive, to teach them about relationships, to teach them everything. And so, and abductees do that, and then they forget immediately, just like an abduction, what has happened, and they're completely controlled. They can't say, I'll be back in a minute, just hang on there for a second, and then come out of a closet carrying a 9mm Glock. They can't do that.
All right, that's a gigantic difference between human beings and hybrids, as you call them. Is there any other difference that you're aware of?
No, they are human, except their neurological abilities are impossible to imagine, and they are completely controlling of humans.
Well, that would make them essentially a master race.
You said it. I didn't.
I did. I'm not afraid to say it. If you have a group of people able to control the minds and the thoughts and even the visions of others, that is a super race.
Exactly right. I just don't see a wonderful, fulfilling phenomenon that is happening to us, that we're begging to hurry up and come here. I just don't see that. It's not what people tell me. Okay, I'll take it. That's not what people tell me. I've run little experiments with people. I tell them, "No, I don't want you to tell me anything bad. I don't want to hear anything bad. I don't want to hear anything that I don't like. You understand?"
Professor,
tell me anything bad, I will say to them, and do hypnosis,
right.
And they just couldn't care less.
Hold on, Professor, hold on. We've got a break. We'll be right back. This is Art Bell and Midnight.
Midnight in the desert spans the world. To call us from outside the U.S. and Canada only, use Skype with a headset mic if on a computer and call MITD55. That's MITD55.
That was not an internet problem. That was my once-a-night problem with Ross. At least that one wasn't. All right, what we're hearing tonight is astounding. From Professor David Jacobs, and is just... it's scary. It's astounding and it's scary. I mean, what have we got here? What are we talking about? We're talking about, if you listen very carefully, we're talking about a master race of people who look just like us, who are fully aware. He calls them hybrids, fully aware they have the ability to control others' minds. So we not only have a master race, but we have an invasion. And that's what it is, Professor. Again, my word, it's an invasion.
Well, I use the word takeover, I use the word invasion. I guess I use those words in the book as well. The book's title is Walking Among Us, and I explain in the book that when people asked me some years back, "Do you think they're walking among us?" that was my favorite question to answer. I love that question because I got to say, absolutely not. There's none. That's ridiculous. Nobody's walking among us. That's just not happening. And I felt good then because I could say no. You know what I mean? And I was sane and all that. Then after a while, I realized it was my least favorite question. I began to hate that question because I had to say, well, I had to beat around the bush. Well, maybe it's possible. You know, anything can happen. And now I just say yes.
Well, I mean, we have to immediately find these people, tie them to a tube before, put kindling at their feet, and burn them.
Well, that's one way of dealing with it. Now,
I'm being facetious, folks.
Oh, I know, and so am I. But the problem is that since they can control other humans, if you come towards them with your rope and all you're going to do is say, "Oh, this is a really good person. I'll just put this rope around myself and put some lighter fluid on, and I'll just burn myself up." You know,
that's a good point.
It's a difficult situation all the way around. And what this book is about is the processes and the procedures and the bureaucracy involved with settling people down on Earth and letting them blend in. And how do they do that? And what do they do? And how is that accomplished? And it's a whole world unto itself.
Okay, these are amazing, amazing things you're saying. And so I've got to ask you, how do you know that these abilities you speak of are for real? How do you know this?
Well, like I said, one woman who I've been working with since 1987. I've known her for decades, practically.
Right.
And she's a wonderful person. She's just honest. She's an honest person. Everybody I've worked with who's in this book has been an absolutely rigorously honest person. And here's something else that people have to understand. People come to me who are high-functioning people, who I mentioned before, you know, university professors and
yes.
psychiatrists and psychologists and medical professionals and all that. And they're coming to me to examine their abduction experiences, knowing full well that if anybody finds out about this, it would destroy their careers. Absolutely, positively, without question.
Mm-hmm.
All a psychiatrist has to say is that I've been abducted by little gray men from another planet. That's all they got to say if they don't ever want to work in the mental health field again.
That's right.
And so, therefore, there's no reason whatsoever to come to me at all and take the chance that I myself am some sort of goofball who's gonna use their real names and set it right to the New York Times or something like that. But they're taking that chance because they desperately will want to know what has been happening to them throughout the course of their entire lives, and they can't figure it out, and they need to have help by a person who can help them figure it out. There's no reason to do that if they're faking it. They never tell anybody afterwards. They never write a letter, an article saying, see, I faked it. It's great. See, this guy Jacobs, he's a jerk. He fell for it. That just doesn't happen.
All right. But let me be, again, I want to be straight on this. So you're basing your claims on the fact that you have been told this by person after person after person under hypnosis that has been abducted or complains that they were abducted, right?
They were abductees, and they've been abductees in childhood, yes.
All right. Am I to assume that, for example, there was a minor, I guess what we would consider a minor genetic modification made to what turned out to be these hybrids with this ability that we've been talking about to control thoughts?
Well, there is a spectrum of hybridization. It's probably in a smooth curve, but what I've done is bifurcated it into different types, just to sort of get a handle on it. Like, for example, hybrids who look half alien and half human and really look weird, they have specific tasks on board a UFO. They usually take care of babies and very small children, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And there's other ones that have tasks as well. Who would not be able to fit in here, and they're just part of the program. What we're looking at is a massive global program of hybridization that's going on. The ones who are moving in, though, are the culmination of the program, of the actual physiology of the program. Now comes the social context, which is moving in. The thing about the hybrids is that they are 100% loyal to the ones above, as they call them, which means the ones who are calling the shots, who are, in fact, and here comes controversy, the insect-looking ones. I call them insectolents. They are the ones who are in control and calling the shots. They're the ones who tell other people what to do. They give orders. They don't take orders.
All right. I might as well stick my neck out and ask, since you've determined all of this, have you determined what their motivation is, what they intend to do with these hybrids?
No. How's that?
Well, it's a good flat answer.
Right. We don't know the motivation. In other words, we don't know the ultimate why question. Why are... Now, I'm projecting this ahead. I'm calling this global acquisition. I hate to say it, but you have to remember this is a global phenomenon. It's not happening. If I found it in my corner of southeastern Pennsylvania, it's not possible that this is where they were setting down the first hubris to blend into the society. It's just not possible. If I found it here, it's happening everywhere. And so, the chances are so much against it. So it's happening everywhere, and that includes Pakistan and Japan and Korea and all through Latin America and all through Europe, of course. And that's what that means, I think. It seems to me. I'm extrapolating here. So the question is, well, why are they doing this? What is this all about? If I call it global acquisition, maybe I'm wrong. Why are they doing this? And we don't know the answer to that. Now, the interesting thing about not knowing the answer is that this is a phenomenon. The abduction phenomenon is either psychological or it's happening. There's nothing in the middle. With UFO sightings, there's plenty of middle. You see something up there, everybody sees something up there, and it's not a UFO. They think it's a UFO, they reported their investigation, and it's not a UFO, it's a plane, it's a blimp, it's a cloud, it's whatever.
Yeah.
And with this phenomenon, it's either psychological or it's happening. There's no way you can explain it in another way. It's not sexual abuse in childhood, which is nonsensical. And has no science behind it whatsoever. Mm-hmm. But the fact is, though, that if this were psychological, they would make up the why, just like they're making everything else up. What to stop them from making up why? Because they want to, play bowling ball with the planets or something like that, or because they're protecting us from ourselves, and it's around the world, and they have to do it because we're going to wreck other planets or whatever, you know. But the insect-like ones simply do not tell their motivations. And when sometimes people ask hubrids, why are you here? You know, what's the point of all this? They'll say, my job, my task is to live here. That's all I know. That's all they know. They don't know. In other words,
God. You know what you have said is so astounding. A master race that is capable of mind control. We don't yet know their motives, but they're probably ultimately not good. I mean, they've got something they want to do. I have not yet seen the hubrids, as it were, improve our lives in any way.
Well, I think it's still fairly early on, and before we begin to understand that something else is going on. Here's one generalization you can make about the aliens, and this is a large generalization, but it's probably accurate. Doing this, planetary acquisition, as I call it, in some way benefits them.
Sure.
It's got to be good for them. It can't be bad for them. They wouldn't be putting in almost a century's worth of time and energy into this
for
nothing, right? That brings me to another point. Time. How old are these insectolins? How old are they? How do they age, you know? Now, we have things, our ages are relatively short lived. I mean, they're not like some, grasshoppers or whatever that live for one day. You know, they fly up in the air and they 12 hours of lifespan. But we have trees that are 3,000 years old, 5,000 years old, and some people say that bacteria can last that long and even longer. But for let's just say, 100 years long for a human, I wish. That's not very long. It's possible that they have very, very, very long lifespans, and therefore time is relatively meaningless for them. So they can continue on kind of like forever and ever doing this until they have judged that that's enough, and now they can control the planet or do whatever they want to do. I don't think that that's the case, but I do think that time is on their side, and so we might still have a long wait before there's any kind of serious sense that something is amiss in this society. But once again, this is speculative. It's guesswork, and the reason it's guesswork is because abductees don't know.
Yeah, well, I'm going to try to back up and try to, for example, do you have any proof or have you seen hybrids control the thoughts of others?
Oh, yes. Yeah, no, I have.
You have.
That. Yeah, I have simple accounts of that in the book. For example, now I'm going to say something crazy. Everything else I said wasn't crazy. Now I'm going to say something crazy.
Okay.
Bernard took his hybrid to a baseball game. That was one of the things he told me. He took a hybrid to he's a huge Baltimore Orioles fan. And he would drive down from New Jersey all the way down to Baltimore to see his dear and beloved Orioles. And he always went with one of his children. Had season tickets, and so I mean, not up for every game, but you know, weekends or whatever. And he told me that he decided that he came for a session, and he told me that he down at a game a couple weeks ago, and he went down alone this time. I said, alone? Oh, so you didn't go down with one of your kids? And he hedged a little bit about that, trying to remember, and he said, no. No, he didn't think he did. I said, well, do you still have your extra ticket? No, he doesn't have the ticket. I said, well, do you remember what you did with the ticket? They just stand out in front of the stadium saying, ticket here, yeah. Got a ticket, you know. He couldn't remember whether he did that or not. Now, this was only 2 weeks ago. I said, this is what's called logical questioning. I said, well, was there somebody sitting in the seat next to you, or was it empty?
Right.
When you got there? He couldn't remember that either.
Wow.
So we did a session on this. Now, this is a guy in his 50s who's a businessman. We did a session on this. He owned his own company. We did a session on this, and he was driving down, and he went off onto off of a 95, the major highway here on the East Coast, and stopped on a side street, and there was his friend Eric waiting for him. And got in the car, and the first thing they were going to the ball game, and the first thing he noticed was that Eric was wearing a jacket, I guess it was, that said Toronto Blue Jays on it. And so Bernard said, well, you can't do that because we're going to an Orioles game, and you know, you got to get with the spirit of the crowd and so forth. And so they decided, when they got to Camden Yard, they went into a store that sold Orioles paraphernalia, and he went in, the hybrid, the Eric, and he picked out a shirt that said Orioles on it. And he walked past held the shirt in his hand or whatever it was. He walked past the cashier who he nodded to, and she nodded to him with a smile, and he walked out of the store with the shirt.
Unknowing smile, no doubt.
Yeah, but he paid nothing for it, and she
right.
didn't say, hey, wait a minute.
I understand. Yes.
She just, he had her controlled.
Yes.
And the other people in the store, too, who
okay.
might have seen it.
All right. Professor, do you have any way of even guessing at how many of these hybrids walk among us?
I don't, but I know it's one hell of a lot. The thing is, we know that there's thousands and thousands and thousands and tens of thousands and maybe hundreds of thousands and almost certainly millions of people who are hybrids in the United States. I'm sorry, who are abductees in the United States.
Uh-huh.
We know this roughly from our Roper poll and both Hopkins and I have gotten thousands and thousands of letters and emails from abductees. I get them every day of my life from around the country and around the world. And so there's a lot of them. But when hybrids come down and are attached to an abductee to help them move in and say that, you know, you have to have towels and a shower and stuff like that, that they're also seeing other abductees. It's not like they're waiting a couple of days for things to settle down or whatever. They're seeing other abductees as well. So each hybrid has a group of abductees who help them. And we know, therefore, that there's a lot of abductees, but there's also one hell of a lot of hybrids being put into place they were, one of my people showed me, took a photograph of an apartment complex where they were moving in at Lake Nipsgrant, Pennsylvania. I drove up there and drove around, and all I got was very suspicious looks from the locals who lived there. It was not exactly in a high crime area, but it was not a palatial mansion area either. And I couldn't tell. I had it in my mind that one of these days I'd get some political paraphernalia. And I'd knock on people's doors, handing out pamphlets for local candidates somewhere, and I'd have a hidden camera on my body, and they'd open the door and they'd say, "No, I don't know what that is. Go away." But I'd have a picture of each person and maybe get the abductee to identify. But that sort of never came to fruition.
All right. Well, some of these, Professor, may be my words, but when you begin talking about hybrids, creatures that are only part human, the part we see mostly, that are capable of, wait a minute, that are capable of mind control.
Yep.
All this orchestrated by an insect-like race of aliens.
Right.
That are creating a master race and are conducting an invasion of Earth. And, you know, it's nothing short of that, what you're saying. You may not use the words. It may be me that use the words, but I'm just putting together what you're saying. You're going to scare the holy you-know-what out of people.
I've already done that to myself. I mean, there's nothing that isn't scary about this. I look at my, I have two young men who are my sons. I look at the future for them, and I think, oh, my God, what's going to happen to them, you know? I wish I was on the other side where everything was loving and wonderful and benevolent and environmentally friendly, but that's just not what people have told me. As I was saying to you before, I would tell people, I don't want to hear anything bad, and then I would order them, do not tell me anything bad. And then do hypnosis with them, and then they just tell me the same thing. They couldn't care less what I say. All they remember is what's happening to them. You know, they don't. It's not my feelings they're trying to deal with. They're trying to deal with the reality of what's happening to them.
Well, I remember, Professor, a lot of movies that have dealt with invasions have featured people like yourself who have realized what's going on and have tried to tell people what's going on and generally have been roundly ostracized by those that, you know, you've told. For example, let me ask, have you run this by any of your colleagues?
Well, here's the thing about academics. When it comes to UFO abductions,
yes.
Let me start with scientists first.
Okay.
You know, scientists have discovered something that goes faster than the speed of light, and what that something is the speed at which they get stupid when they talk about abductions. It happens faster than the speed of light. It's a miracle. And academics in general are pretty much like that. I've only had two people in teaching at Temple from 1975 to 2011. I only had two people who ever engaged me in conversation about the subject. Both of them were in the liberal arts. Not a single scientist, not a physicist, an astronomer, a chemist, not a single scientist at Temple University in 37 years I was there, or whatever it was, asked me, "Jacobs, what the hell is all this about? What's going on? What's the matter with you? Are you nuts?" Not a single person said that to me. Not one ever.
Yes, but how many have said, "My God, Professor, you're right. What do we do?"
No, that's not going to happen. You have to remember, I receive more publicity at Temple University to everybody's embarrassment than any other person outside of the sports program. And yet it did not pry loose one scientist to walk over to my office and say, what kind of an idiot am I, you know? I would be glad to answer that question. I'm an enormous idiot, of course. But the fact is, though, that is generally speaking the entire scientific community in the United States, with the exception of those scientists who got interested in UFOs and stuck with them years and years and years ago, most of whom are now, like me, long in the tooth.
Right. Even among UFO researchers and paranormal investigators, what you're saying is really uber. I'm not sure what to say.
It's over the top, so to speak.
Yes, over the top, so to speak. Because there has got to be some sort of dastardly motive to this. You would not go through what these creatures are going through to put these kind of hybrids on Earth unless it was a... Well, because as you pointed out, we have relatively short lifespans. So... are they building toward generations? Are they trying to get millions of them here or a certain number before they do whatever they're going to do?
Yeah, don't know that. But my guess is yes, they've got to get a certain number here before they can do what they're going to do.
Okay, but that would have to occur within a certain lifetime. Or have you determined that hybrids, when they breed, either with other hybrids or humans, end up producing more hybrids? What happens there?
They end up producing more hybrids, probably, and that depends on what happens. I do know that when hybrids have had intercourse with abductees, they then get pregnant, and the fetus is removed about 10 or between 9 and 11 weeks, just as if they had an embryo inserted in them, but it bypasses some of the procedures on tables. However, this is different, and so we don't know yet whether or not hybrids can, in fact, have children with abductees. We don't know that. We do know that they are not to have sexual relations with female hybrids.
How do we know that?
The hybrids have said this, that they have to, you know, they stick with regular humans, because they otherwise it's I guess they think that it's just not spreading out the phenomenon enough in some way. I don't know.
Hitting on a female hybrid would be useless.
Yeah. And what's the point? The point is you want to spread your seed, so to speak.
Right. Well, she doesn't want anything to do with it, though, right?
I'm sorry. Say that again.
I said she wouldn't want a thing to do with it.
If by she you mean the female hybrid,
right.
No, they have to mate with humans. They have to have intercourse with humans. With human females.
Okay, so you're saying that hybrids may not mate.
They may not mate. That is correct. They are told they cannot mate. They should not mate. They are not supposed to, and they follow orders. They're really good at following orders.
Okay, that would make sense if you're trying to propagate quickly. You would only want them to mate with a human.
Yes, and the question then is, will they have a watered-down hybrid that is born, or would they just take out the hybrid fetus on board a UFO eventually and put it in a tank and just go through the standard procedures? We don't know that because, as far as I know, with the women whom I've worked with, they have not reported feeling pregnant as a result of hybrids.
All right.
I don't think think. I'm thinking of maybe one exception.
Professor, hold on. This is such incredible stuff. I mean, if everything we're hearing right now is true, then surely we are at, right?
Yeah.
And if not, we ought to be. Something else for the military-industrial complex to get busy with. I'm Art Bell. This is Midnight in the Desert. Holy mackerel.
Absolutely.
What?
Absolutely. Listen to me.
The speed of light in the darkness. This is Midnight in the Desert with Art Bell. Now, here's Art.
You know, I've been doing talk radio now for decades, right? Radio for all my life. And in all my life, and in all those decades, I don't think that I have ever heard anything like what I'm hearing tonight from Professor David Jacobs. Boiled down to this, it seems to be the many, many abductions that he has studied over the years, and it is many, 1,150, involve sperm and eggs. I'm sort of summing up here so that you all are with me, I hope. And that what's being produced one way or the other with this is what he calls hybrids. Hybrid humans, hybrids, he calls them. This would be a race of people who look just like us, indistinguishable from a normal human. In fact, normal to the point of almost being odd. In other words, no outstanding features that would mark them or let us recognize them in any way. So the close-in norm, right? The normal human. They're capable of mind control. This is all being done by a race of aliens that are insectoid. What it amounts to, according to the professor, is an invasion of Earth. This is an invasion of Earth. And it's underway. It's apparently well underway. Professor, do you have any indication of when this aspect of it, the hybrids, began?
Well, like I said, I started hearing about it in 2003. It's almost impossible for me to have heard about it first, as you know, just after it happened. It probably happened. It started happening some years beforehand, and I didn't realize it. But the people who I had been working with weren't talking about it, and then suddenly, a bunch of them started talking about it. So I knew that it had reached here in the southeastern Pennsylvania or Pennsylvania area, but it had to have been beforehand, and it had to have been at other places as well. Mm-hmm. So we don't really know that, because once again, we get all our information from abductees, and they don't know that either.
Right.
And the Hebrews don't know that. They don't have a need to know that. What difference does it make to them? You know.
Okay, Professor, is there any way? Let us say, for yourself, most familiar with them, to recognize a hybrid if you saw one, and if so, how?
No, there is not. So if you see a weird person who looks weird, has big eyes, is strange, and talks weird,
they'd be okay.
He's just a weird guy, that's all.
So all these people would appear abnormally normal, if you can put it that way.
So to speak.
Yeah. All right. I get questions, Professor, as we go on with the program. Chris in Madison, Wisconsin, asks a pretty interesting question. Can hybrids read our minds?
Yes, they can. They can tell what you're thinking. They have to stare at you, and they can tell what you're thinking. Now, having said that, it's not as clear-cut as you might think. It is possible for abductees to hide things in their mind. How they do this, I don't know. And have other thoughts come to the forefront, which they will be glad to have the person know. But in general, yes, they can read. I'm going into the fine points here. But in general, they can read people's minds. They talk telepathically, which automatically gives them an entree. And they can do other. I won't even go into it. They can do other things. They can stare at people from a distance of an inch or so, right into their eyes, just like gray aliens do routinely for humans that we've known about since I wrote my book Secret Life back in '92. And they can do that also, and they can dig deeper, and they can see what a person was doing, and they can do most of the things neurologically that gray aliens can do.
You know, I'm actually sitting here in shock. And I imagine a lot of people sitting and listening to this are in shock right now. Or they're saying, oh, this guy's nuts.
Yeah, well, that's probably all true, including the last part. But the thing is that in my 1998 book, The Change, it sort of said that this was going to happen. Not all the details, but there was going to be this change. Soon they would all be together, and everybody would know his place, and all that sort of stuff. And so there was a harbinger of it years and years and years ago. And when I wrote Secret Life, my first book, in 1992, my whole mindset was different, because I thought at that time that they were here to experiment on us, that they were interested in us, that they were learning about us and all that sort of stuff. And I kind of kept that mental set in my mind all the way through the book. But even then, they were staring into people's eyes, and they were creating hybrids, and people had and when we go back to 1981 with Bud Hopkins' Missing Time,
right.
he coined the phrase the word hybrid for them,
right.
And so it keeps going back and back and back.
But Professor, when did it become apparent to you that what we were facing was actually an invasion? It's a hard word, invasion.
Well, when I figured it was probably going to be something like that, but I didn't talk that much about it because I didn't know in the threat. But when Bernard came in, and then other people started to tell me the same story, then I began to think, this is not just coming in here and looking around and trying to figure out how things work. This was I began to expand my vision a little bit to the global quality of this, and also to the workforce involved, and that's a whole other story, and to everything else that's going on, and absolutely everything pointed to a takeover of some sort. Mm-hmm. I mean, there has to be, if they're going to live here, as you said before, they will be the master race. But it's not even a race; it's a species. It's like chimpanzees and humans; it's two different species, even though chimps are real smart.
Okay, so one would wonder, for example, I'm wondering, would their motive be to slowly increase their numbers until they can essentially take over, or would their motive be to simply continue doing it until the job is complete and we're all changed?
Yeah, and I don't think it will advance that far. I don't think you have to have everybody on Earth being a part of the game, so to speak, part of the hybrid world. I think that there has to be my guess is, now once again, I'm just speculating, but my guess is that they'll reach a critical mass at one point when they can control just about everybody, and that's all they need.
Oh, that would be all they would need, and it would be indeed a takeover, and at that point, one has to wonder what use they would have for those of us not part of it.
That's something that I have thought about. A couple of people have said that there will be a group of humans who are left over as a breeding stock in case something goes wrong with parts of the program or whatever. But It hasn't been said by enough people for me to think that this is what's going to happen. And so I'm unsure of that. But it could be. There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I don't see any flaws in it. You know, it's fine. Except, of course, that the whole thing is criminal. But the fact is, though, that once again, we just don't know the future.
Maybe you might even want to call it a war crime, actually.
Whatever it is, it ain't good.
War crime fits it just fine, actually, because this is, as you have described it, an invasion, which makes it a war, unless you just want to let it happen.
Right. It's an invasion. I'm not sure if we could actually reject it or put up a defense to it.
Holy moly.
So I don't know if it's a war. Now, there's a guy named Mike Mencken. Mike Mencken is a really good man, and what he does is he's figured out that if they're going to control us telepathically on board a UFO or to abduct us or whatever, which they do, of course, why not put the head in a person's head in a helmet or something, or try to stop whatever energy is going out of our brains and into their brains and vice versa. And see if you can interrupt that. And so he makes these what look like World War II aviation pilot hats, although he's got some sort of baseball type hats now and other hats that have a certain kind of filling in them, a plastic type of thing or whatever it is that abductees say actually does prevent abductions. The problem is you can't wear them 24/7. So there's plenty of opportunities to be abducted anyway, but it gives people comfort and relief, at least for a certain time. Now, here's the situation. Mike is a good guy. He's a great guy, and I like him a lot. But what we need is a group of heavy-duty scientists who put their heads together and try to figure this thing out and try to see what kind of countermeasures we can come up with.
Mm-hmm. Professor Tina in Oregon says, well, we're screwed. What a brilliant way to take over a planet. I wonder how many in power are hubris.
Well, I don't think they've gotten to that point yet. I think it's much, much, much too early for that. You know, most of them have no idea what the name of the country is. They don't know. They never ask, and they seem to know nothing about politics. One thing that they are frightened of, and various people have told me this, is violence. But it's not violence in terms of war. It's violence in terms of having young hybrids picked on by violent humans, let's just say, in a park or something.
I completely understand.
That concerns them. But one of the first things I noticed very, very early on when I was doing research for Secret Life is that when these beings talk with abductees on board a UFO, they never ask them questions that have to do with American organizations or institutions or political structure or anything like that. And I thought early on, that's so odd. And then I realized the reason that they probably don't ask questions about that is because we will be living under their institutions or top-down governments or whatever it is.
Are there any indications at all, Professor, that they are making final plans to bring this to their logical, whatever their logical conclusion is, I guess the end of us in a way?
I haven't heard that yet because the process of taking egg and sperm is still ongoing. But I have heard something that I had not heard, that I had heard before in bits and pieces and didn't pay much attention to it. But now I've heard it in much greater detail than ever before, and it's distressing. And it has to do with some abductees, not all, and not even the ones that are helping, not all the ones that are helping hybrids, but just some abductees who are being trained to do the work of hybrids and gray aliens. Stare deeply into people's eyes, make them do this, make them do that with their minds, finds people who live in another state through some sort of apparatus that they can look through, but is still dealing with their minds, and teaching them basically how to be hybrids, even though they're not. And they don't want to have anything to do with this whatsoever. And they feel like they're that even when they're teaching children how to get dressed, they feel like they're traitors to the human race. You know, there's this guilt that goes to them, even on board the object. And but this business of training hybrids with other hybrids who sit next to them, teach them how to do this, on how to stare into a person's eyes, how to make a person think he's, for example, I have this as one of the examples, make a person think he's jumping off a cliff in a room and force him to do that even though he's scared to death and doesn't want to do it. And that is another abductee. And there's a lot of stuff that I didn't put into the book that's even very, very, very routine, getting abductees to stand up in another room when there's a wall between you and walk into the room that the one who's being trained to do this kind of stuff is standing in.
All right. Could they, for example, control another person to the point of causing that person to essentially take their own life, commit suicide?
I don't know, but I would not be surprised if they could do that. I don't know, because they got this one guy to think this is a little bit more complicated, but to think he was jumping off a cliff. And they did not want him to go to the point of actually jumping off the cliff, because he would just fall to the floor and he might, as the alien said, be damaged.
It might be a great way to practice getting somebody to actually do that.
That's exactly what they were doing. They were just trying to strengthen the person's ability to control that other person, even to the point of jumping off a cliff.
I'm telling you, Professor, in all the years I've done talk radio, nobody has scared me the way you're scaring me tonight. You're really doing a job on me.
It is frightening. There's no doubt about it. There's just nothing that's soothing about it. There's nothing that's calming about it. And once again, I don't have a stake in this. I wish it was calming and soothing. I would much, much rather hear that than what people are telling me.
All right. What about this thought? If what you're saying is true, it seems to me that your life would be in almost immediate danger.
That's going to be the subject of my third book, my last book, rather. My life was not in danger, but what happens is when abductees come to me and their friends, the aliens, find out about it, the first thing that the aliens do is try to stop them from talking to me. That is a breach. This is a clandestine phenomenon, and it's secretive, and it's extremely successful secretively. To breach this, to go ahead and tell people what they're doing is not good, and they try to get people to stop. And by and large, they do get people to stop. One time, years and years ago, I was doing a session. It was our 10th session with a guy. This guy had a PhD in mathematics. I was doing a session with him, and in the 10th session, he was telling me what was happening, and then suddenly he sat bolt upright. And he said, I shouldn't be telling you this. And he got up and he said goodbye, and then he walked out, and I never saw him again in a session. Now, they obviously had gotten to him saying, you're doing the wrong thing, you shouldn't be going there, you shouldn't be telling him that, and all that sort of stuff, and then they got to him. And other people have done similar things. But this one woman was extremely resistant, and she kept talking to me and talking to me and talking to me. And they did all sorts of things to her, and they even have they have methods of violence that they use. And this has been reported to me by several different people, so I know that this is. And the methods are so somewhat off the wall that it's hard it's not the first thing that would come to mind.
All right, Professor, would you hold on? We're coming up on a break, and I'm going to take a moment early just to say, my God. Are you all listening to this? I'm going to open the lines. I really think you need to be able to ask questions. So our public line is area code 952-225-5278. That's 952-225-5278. Skype in North America, of course, MITD51. And in the rest of the world, MITD55. In all my years of doing talk radio, I have never, ever run into something quite like this. This really is frightening. And I must say, if you were thinking of devious ways to take over a species, it doesn't get much better than this. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell, and this is Midnight in the Desert. Got something odd going on, and boy, you would expect that during a show like this, wouldn't you? Really odd. Nobody can call in. You're getting a busy signal. I just tested it myself. So something's up with the phone system that I suspect is related to the internet problem. I am getting Skype calls by the dozens, so no problem there. You can get hold of us using Skype at MITD51 for North America and MITD55 for the rest of the world, but none of your calls are coming in. So we're going to have to probably deal just with Skype. I understand it would be very, very busy. My goodness. Between what we're talking about tonight, between that and everything else that's going on, it's just a total mind-blower. This entire program is a mind-blower. Professor, welcome back.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
I'm going to put a few on the air with you from Skype, if that's okay. I mean, obviously, people are going to have a lot of questions about this. Larry, you're on the air.
Hello, Art. How are you?
You're listening to the show, right?
Yeah, and I'm feeling the way you are.
Yeah.
But, Mr. Jacobs, my question is...
Indeed, Professor Jacobs, actually.
Professor Jacobs. Did you ever run into any of your abductees that were able to maybe stop the phenomenon by invoking Christ?
No, that question comes up every once in a while. Nobody has been able to stop it by invoking any religious figure, and of course this cuts across all religions and all races and all everybody's, but invoking the name of a religious person is has meant nothing.
Doesn't work. Okay, well, that, yeah, good try of that removes that one. I guess this is a pretty good question. Is there any defense that you can imagine or that you've thought of yet against what they're doing to us?
You know, I'm not a scientist, that's the thing. If the scientific community would pay attention to this just a little bit, they might be able to figure something out that could stymie them or slow them down or do something that would be beneficial for us. And I just don't see that happening in the near future. And besides that, this program is now so old. I mean, it goes back down to the 20th century that, and their technology is so unbelievably advanced that I just can't imagine stopping it. Maybe they could, but I should be talking about this.
No, I know. That's an obvious question. I mean, there's got to be some defense. There's got to be some way to fight back.
Right. Right, and there must be some way. There has to be some way, and it's up to the scientific community to put their collective heads together and figure out a way to do it. But I'm a historian. I have trouble enough opening up a door handle.
All right. Let's try another one. Chaz, you're on the air. Hello.
Hey, Art. Hey, guys. How you doing?
Well,
I have a question.
Yes.
If there's really, we have no way of knowing whether we can defend ourselves against them, what were the medical conditions of the people that are actually being abducted? Did any of them have any type of diseases or, you know, ill health or anything like that? Or were they all just pretty fit?
Well, that's a pretty good question, actually.
One of the people in my book, Allison, died in 2011. She had been with me since 1993, and the aliens did not do anything to alleviate her type 1 diabetes, and they didn't care. There's more where she came from, in other words, that's my sense of it. Miracle cures is not in their benefit. It points to something odd going on. And so we don't see miracle cures, although I have, in fact, cataloged a few of them in Secret Life when people were very young and were kids, and they, in fact, were cured, two different people of something. But when people get cancer, generally speaking, they do nothing. If they have heart disease, they do nothing. Look at Carla Turner, a famous abduction researcher, died of breast cancer, and they let nature take its course, knowing that there's millions of abductees out there. It'll take a place.
Yeah, I mean, why do anything? It just gets in the way of their goal anyway. So, you know, just let nature take its course, I guess, and they proceed with their program, their insidious program.
Yeah, abductees are killed in car crashes as well.
There you go, Jazz.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, guys.
You're welcome.
Okay.
I sure wish there was... This is horrible. Absolutely horrible. That's all I can say.
It's fairly disastrous. I would have preferred to just be snoozing next to the abductee while they're saying the same thing over and over and over again, but that's just not what happened. I mean, I didn't cause this to happen, as some people would think. They don't tell me what I want them to tell me. You know what I mean?
And I would think that this would all be the last thing you'd want to hear.
It is the last thing I want to hear. I didn't sign up for this. I signed up for... back in 1965, 66, when I started looking at UFOs, I thought this was contact between two species who would meet together on the White House lawn and exchange presents and gifts and cure cancer and all that sort of stuff. That was sort of the sense I had, because they were so unbelievably advanced to be able to get here in the first place. But when I started, you know, when I was introduced to Bud Hopkins back in 1982, and then I started to understand that there really was something to this abduction phenomenon, and he introduced me to abductees, and of course I read his books, and I realized that this was a much more complicated situation than I thought, and I couldn't for the life of me figure out why they would have babies and all that. And then when I started doing my research based on, you know, my ideas from Bud, it just sort of led in this trajectory that Bud was having, but then the trajectory began to shift into these other things while maintaining the original stuff there. But it just, the more I looked into it, the wider it got and the more I learned about it. And then I people began to tell me, starting in 2003, about these hubrids, and then I was off to the races, so to speak.
This is off the chart scary. Karen from Toronto asked the professor to explain the mechanics of hybrid human mind control. Does he have any taped recordings or documentation of what he claims the deductees have told him?
Well, we have no documentation in terms of close-ups or I mean, there's all sorts of shadowy photographs and all that, but there's nothing on board. And there's no pictures of humans standing there with their eyes wide open and aliens staring into them at a distance of either touching foreheads or an inch away.
What about transcripts or recordings, Professor, from...
Well, I've got transcripts and recordings of all my sessions, all of them.
So you have plenty to back this up?
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah. Oh.
My
God. With the abduction phenomenon, I mean, you can't remember what a person said. You have to record everything, and then you can't listen to, in those days, cassette tapes. You can't listen to any tape. You have to sit there for another 3 hours listening to something you already spent 3 hours listening to. Mm-hmm. You have to have it transcribed, and then you can read through it and look at the certain points that you're looking for and so forth. The reports... I'm the one who sort of discovered this neurological basis way early on. I put it in 1990 in Secret Life. And the only way that I could think of what they were actually doing was they were, when I asked the person, well, when he's staring at you like that, can you close your eyes? Can you avert your eyes? You know, can you do whatever? And they said, no, they're just looking straight ahead. And then I realized that the only nerve that is accessible from the outside, that is viewable, essentially, is the optic nerve. And you can see it in the back of the eye. And my guess is, and I'm not a physician, but my guess is that they're hooking into the optic nerve and then using it as a conduit to go to any other neurological sites in the brain. And they can energize anything they want. They can add stuff, detract stuff. They can put images in. They can do all sorts of things. For example, here is something that was played out in a woman's mind. Now, the phenomenon is amazingly mundane. For example, she sees in her mind's eye now. I can't absolutely say it was a mind. She thinks it might have been in a screen or it might have been in her mind, but this is typical mind stuff. She sees a woman who is walking down a sidewalk in some setting. It's a nice setting in a town. And she stops at a bus stop, and it's a sheltered bus stop, and she sits down in the bus stop.
Yes.
There's another woman sitting next to her. The bus pulls up. The other woman gets in, and then she gets in, and she takes her money out of her purse, and she puts it in the bus stop money place, and she walks to the end of the bus or wherever, and she sits down. That's the end of the movie. Immediately, an alien turns to her and says, "What did she do wrong?" So the woman says, "Well, she looked pretty good to me. Everything was fine. She looked a little, maybe too nervous or something. But other than that, everything looked fine." You know, that's the level of learning that's going on here. And who would think of an image of a drama like that? How many Hollywood producers would have that as you know, as something that they could sell to a major movie company to capitalize on as a drama. Here's another one. A 10-year-old kid, a growing, probably Hubert kid, comes down with a woman's house. This is typical stuff. With a caretaker. It was an older guy in his 20s. And she takes him around the house and shows him this and shows him that and shows him other things. Now they go into the living room, and she sits on the couch, and the caretaker sits on the couch, and the kid sits in this upholstered chair, but he's sitting right on the edge. He's sitting on the edge. He's not sitting back or anything.
Yes.
So the caretaker says to him, "Sit back." So he sits back a little bit, but he's sort of ramrod straight. And the caretaker urges him, "You know, what's wrong with you? Just sit back." And he doesn't want to. And then the abductee realizes what's going on, and she says, no, no, you're not going to fall through the back of it. It's got a backing inside the upholstery, inside the covers, and you won't fall through. So he gets up, and he walks around to the back of the chair, and he feels the back of the chair. He says, oh, I see. Okay, yeah. And then he gets back on that chair, and he slowly, slowly slides back, and then he slowly hits the back, and it's okay.
So a teaching moment. All right.
But it's so mundane. It's so off the wall.
Yeah, it is.
So who would think of something like that? And I have account after account by person after person of things like that going on. It's just astounding.
I should let people ask questions. Jaroslaw, I believe it is, outside the country somewhere. Hello?
Hello.
Hi there. Where are you?
I'm in Poland.
Poland. Okay.
Great. Gosh.
Yes. So what do you think about all this? You've been listening tonight, right?
Yes, I am.
And?
I have a question. How can you know for sure that it is actually bad for human race? I mean, it could be good for human race, maybe just another step of development of human race, because we already are a product of ET genetic manipulation, as far as I know.
What a question.
Well, I know for a product of genetic manipulation as opposed to genetic change that happens over the millions of years, but any group that can control another group will go ahead and control the group for their own benefit. That has happened, that has never happened like this before, but certainly anybody in power can control others, and oftentimes if they don't like those others, it leads to disaster. It benefits them in some way to do what they're doing, and it doesn't necessarily benefit us. It might. You might be right. It might be good for us in some way. But because this is such a clandestine program, because it is so secretive, and because they are so frightened of anybody saying anything about what's going on, I just can't imagine that it would be for our benefit.
Okay. I just thought, you know, the real evil we must deal right now is globalist bankers, industrial military complex, and such people.
Well, unless we've got this going on, it sounds a lot worse to me.
Yeah, it's, I don't know which is worse right now, but because the program, I think, is still a young program, but it'll get old pretty soon. But I can't see, you know, people said, well, this is just evolution.
Evolution is a natural process, so.
Right, and that's what I say in the book. It's unnatural evolution. It's unnatural. It's not evolution that benefits us necessarily. It benefits them.
Caller in Poland, maybe you're one of them.
I don't think so. I've never have an encounter with ETs or UFO, as far as I know.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for the call. And let me ask you, Professor, when you ask somebody something like I just did, kind of rude, I guess, what would their normal response be? I mean, would it be what he just said? I don't think so. Or...
I never asked a question. Never, ever, 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 ever asked a question. I've learned that I just can't do that because, and when people tell me about their experiences, I've learned to say, oh, that's interesting. And I don't say, oh my God, that sounds like an abduction experience to me. As I said earlier on, I just don't like ruining people's lives, you know, and when people come to me,
but isn't all this about to ruin all our lives eventually?
Yeah, but they've got a life to live for as long as possible. And it's up to them to make the decision. When they come to me after when they fill out my questionnaire and I decide I'll work with them, they have to live within 100 miles of me and all that. I give them very strong warnings about going forward with this. I say, look, you stand on the verge of making a life-changing decision. One of the most important life-changing decisions you will ever make if you do find out that something is going on. And the first thing that happens is you're isolated. If you tell your family about it, they'll think you're crazy and they'll want you to get help. And that's a loving thing for them to do.
And then it may well be that when you get to that help, you will recite essentially what you're saying tonight, and they will affirm the fact that you need help.
They could wind up in the booby hatch. Absolutely.
Exactly. Holy moly.
Not only that, it's worse than that. They oftentimes can't tell their husband or their wife, because if they tell their husband or their wife, the husband's, oh, that's crazy, that's nuts, ha ha ha, that's crazy, that's nuts, and thinks that they, and then it's all fun and games. And then one night, the husband will see something, then realize, oh my God, this is happening, and then not want to be with the wife in close proximity to the wife anymore because they're frightened. Not only that, but when a couple divorces, and if a person knows that the other one is an abductee, the first thing they tell the judge is, this woman thinks she's having sex with aliens. I want the kids.
Yeah, of course. Felipe, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Eric. Hello. My question for your guest, I hope you can hear me okay.
Yes.
Is, you mentioned earlier that eventually these beings would invade the Earth. So my question is, if those of us who choose to cooperate with the aliens, will we get better treatment than everyone else, or will our lives be spared?
Well, you wouldn't know who Hubert or alien-looking human would be. You would not know that. All you would know is that a person came up to you, and you really liked that person, and you just decided to give him all the money in your pocket. That's okay. How you would know, and you'd feel good about it.
Okay.
It never occurred to you that anything odd happened.
That is the most insidious kind of invasion anybody could ever imagine. And that's, believe me, that's what I'm getting. A million computer messages here. So there's a lot of people who are completely buying into this, trust me. And it's just scary. Sassy, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, I have a question for Professor Jacob.
Right.
When these Hubits are all living on Earth, throughout the Earth, how sparsely spread are they? Because wouldn't they stick out by having no family or...
Well, they don't stick out at all. From what I've been told, if I've been listening, they are normal of the normal. In other words, they don't stick out at all.
But they don't have any, like, siblings or parents or cousins.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I mean, how did they explain that?
Yeah, that has not come up so far, and I don't know how they explain that. I do know that they're moving in very young, between the ages of around 17 and 23, and they're moving in small groups, twos, threes, and fours, into apartments.
Wow.
Having said that, there are what I call independent hybrids who move in alone into apartments. They have to learn about what a family is. You got to remember, they have no mother or father that they know of. They have no siblings that they know of. They don't know how old they are. They don't know about aunts and uncles and cousins. And they don't know, if they do know, they don't know what part they have in a family. They don't know any of, they learn all that from abductees. And if they say, they could probably eventually learn to say something, well, I'm an orphan and I was raised in an orphan asylum until I was older or something like that. I'm sure that they'll figure out something to say that the abductees will tell them what to say if that ever comes up. But it's an interesting question and I don't know the absolute answer to it, but it seems to me that it's going to be easy to overcome.
I'm not sure any of this is going to be easy to overcome.
I mean, for them, maybe, but
I almost don't see a way out of this. If what you say is true, then maybe the lady who said we're cooked has it right. We're cooked.
Yeah, that's a pretty good phrase. I tend to think that. There's a chapter at the end of the book which is a speculative chapter. And one of the questions that I ask is, are we the first planet ever to have this happen to? You know, Are we numero uno, number one?
Do you have an answer to that?
Yes. There's no possibility we're the first planet. It's just not possible. And I give about nine reasons why it is not possible that we are the very first in the universe to have this happen. It's probably happened to many, many other planets as well. And there's some other questions that I ask, and I try to clear up this whole internet world of reptilians. You know, reptilians are reported from time to time. That's it. It's unusual. But every once in a while, somebody will say, well, this guy looks reptilian. I really don't like him. Oh, I hate this guy. He's horrible. Oh, God, keep him away from me.
Yeah.
Oh, he's angry. He's this. He's that. I say, well, is he hurting you or anything? No. Well, is he slapping you around? No. Oh, well, is he really aggressive to you? No. Well, what's he doing? Well, he's just doing his standard stuff that everybody else does, but I just hate him. I just hate him. And I think I have a logical explanation for why they're there. I'm going to keep that quiet for a while because there's a lot of transcripts and not a whole lot of me talking in the book.
Tyrone, you're on the air.
Yes, Art. Why do they abduct one person 400 times instead of 400 people once for sampling?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, well, the key idea here is sampling. They abduct one person over and over and over again, not only because they get sperm and eggs, but because they have all sorts of different tasks to do on board the object. When they're kids, they play with hybrid children. When they're older, they teach other hybrid children how to do older, you know, adolescent type things and all that sort of stuff. They have a world which they belong to, which they're involved with that they don't even know about, and that they, when they do learn about it, they wish that they weren't. Having said that, I don't know why people are abducted so often. It's ridiculous. It makes no sense. There's no reason for it, it seems to me. But
well, no reason that we understand. It may well be.
Right. It makes sense for them, and there is a reason for them. For me, I don't know. But this one woman, Betsy, who is sort of the star of the book, she was being abducted every other day almost for a couple of years, a year and a half or whatever it was. I can't remember exactly. Constantly. I would talk with her on the phone, or it would do instant messaging or email, and she would hear clunking going on upstairs, and she said, "I think they're here. I have to get off." And we would do a session on what happened that the night before, and sure enough, you know, and this is a really wonderful person. Her life and her husband's and children revolved around the church, and she wasn't a person who was making up stories to lie to me and all the rest of that stuff. And I've known her since 1999. I'm still in contact with her. In fact, I was in contact with her just a day before yesterday.
All right, Tyrone, anything else?
No, that's about it for now, but I appreciate the answer, Dr. Jacobs.
Thank you very much.
I wish I could give you a fully developed answer to why they're abducted over and over again over the course of a year, but I can't.
Can you give us a fairly fully developed answer to this question? Professor, what you're saying tonight is so uber that it really has to be asked. How honestly sure are you of what you're telling us tonight?
Well, having done abduction research since 1986 by myself, that is to say with hypnosis, and having heard people say things that are not true,
yes,
and having people confabulate like crazy and this, that, and the other thing, and learning that when somebody says something for the first time, you know, it's not evidence, you gotta with other people.
Right.
And knowing some of these people for long periods of time, and knowing their families and this and that, I'm fairly certain that this is true. It's as certain as you can get with humans, you know what I mean? Unless you're actually looking in their window as a peeping Tom and watching them being abducted.
All right, Professor.
Bye.
born in the summertime. It's Alpha and Omega's kingdom come.
Want to take a ride from the high desert and the great American Southwest? This is Midnight in the Desert, exclusively on the Dark Matter Digital Network. To call the show, dial 1-952-CALL-ART. That's 1-952-225-5278.
You know, the hairs on my arm are doing a pretty good job of standing up tonight. Anyway, this is really, really scary stuff. Professor, welcome back.
Well, thanks for continuing to have me on. I'm not exactly the bearer of glad tidings.
Not even close. Not even close. I don't know. Let's go here. Johnny, you're on the air, I guess. Where are you?
Hi, Art. Good evening to you, Dr. Jacob. I'm Johnny Webb in London. A couple of questions I want to ask you over what's been said this evening. To answer the question about Jesus intervening, there was a testimony of a MUFON investigator terminating abductions as a life pattern by Joseph Jordan. And he says there's many cases out there where people have called on Jesus and apparently fallen back down on their beds. Also, my other question was, were you ever able to go into the past of your patients or future to see if they were contacted in other reincarnates? And also, have they managed to speed up the growth of hybrids?
Okay, let's see. The first question was saying the name of a religious deity.
Yes.
What happens... This is the abduction phenomenon. No, wait, the second question was what?
About reincarnation. About reincarnation.
Reincarnation. The third question was... What was the third question?
The third one is, have these entities been able to speed up the growth of a hybrid?
Oh, yeah. No, they develop at the same rate as humans do. But, in terms of reincarnation, there's been no work done on that, and so it doesn't seem to have anything to do with the abduction phenomenon. But the question is religious incantation. Here's what happens, and this is a story of the problems of people who don't know how to do abduction research. They say, I said the name of Jesus, they were there. They left the room, and I fell back on the bed, and I stopped the abduction.
Yeah, I've heard that.
They tell me they were coming in, and I threw a pillow at them. I saw them coming in. They were inside the house. I threw a pillow at them, and then they got out of there, and I stopped the abduction. And they tell me things like that. What they're saying is they were abducted. This happened, that happened, this happened, that happened, that happened, this on and on. They came back to their bedrooms, let's just say, or their car or their backyard or whatever it is, and they sort of came to, they got back into their normal memory a little too soon, and the aliens were still there. So they picked up something and threw them, and they aborted the abduction. They weren't abducted. See what I mean? They came to a little too soon. They came out of the trance or whatever the heck they were in on board the object so that they, you know, to be controlled. And that's what happens. No one has ever stopped an abduction by themselves. I have one other case when a person was about to be abducted and the phone rang. And she was startled enough to answer the phone. It interrupted. That's the only case out of 1,150 that I've ever seen where there might have had an abduction aborted. Maybe.
Johnny?
Well, in your book, The Threat, I remember you talking about whilst being under a hypnotic regression, that there was another entity in the room and they were conscious of you being in that spirit at time. You know? Do you know what I mean?
There was another person in the room, and they were conscious of me?
Yeah, so whether it was, you know, one of the abductees, but there was an entity in the room, and they were conscious of you being, in this present time, hypnotizing your patient, but the patient was letting you know that there's someone in the room with them who knows you're doing what you're doing.
Yes, that does happen. And the answer to that is, don't do that. Stop doing that. You are not to do that. You are hurting us. This gets them very, very upset, very excited, because it is, in fact, a breach of their secrecy program. I was saying earlier that this one woman had violence directed towards her in a very strange way. Ultimately, they couldn't stop her from seeing me, so what they tried to do was to find out where I was and maybe get me to stop seeing her. That's going to be the subject of a book of mine sometime when I'm about 109 years old. But needless to say, they never did get to me, I don't think. They never got to me. But there's a story involved in why they didn't get to me also. So
all right. It sounds like we have several shows to do, Professor. Marion, hello there. You're on the air. Where are you, please?
Hi, Art. I'm in Romania, Bucharest, Romania.
Romania.
Yeah.
Okay. You have a question?
Yes. The question is, what if the professor is a defector of theirs?
Actually, not such a crazy question in a way, Professor.
If I'm a defector?
Yeah, if you're, in essence, a defector of theirs. I mean...
Who, me?
You.
Nothing strange has ever happened to me in my life, and I can remember all aspects of it, or some aspects of it, for, the last 5 or 6 years. No, I can remember when I was a baby, when I was a little boy, and I've got pictures of me all the way through, and my mother was not an abductee, my father was not an abductee, and that's what determines it. If your mother or your father was an abductee, the chances are extremely high that you will be an abductee. But you can't be a defector. You can't get away. Most people, 95%, that's a guess, but it's probably a good guess, 95% of abductees around the world do not know that they're abductees. And even if they think that they're abductees, it's such a crazy subject. They just put it out of their minds to a certain extent, and they think it's dreams. But they know it's not, because it happens in real time. They come, people come back from abductions, and sometimes their clothes are on backwards. And sometimes their clothes, they come back to the bed, their pajamas are off. They're not wearing their pajamas, or their pajamas are on backwards. Sometimes they come back wearing somebody else's clothes. People are physically missing from their normal environments when they're abducted. Police have been called, and search parties, and this and that. And children are searched for their parents, and parents are searched for their children in real time, And people are abducted in groups and can confirm each other's abductions. If you want to hear a story about.
Is there a chance that you may be an enhanced exponent of this?
An exponent of it? I want to see it stopped immediately. I'm not an exponent. I'm a person who has learned about it and now is telling everybody what I've learned. And you have to remember that this is a phenomenon that is global. It's worldwide, and it's been going on for a long time. And the only indication of it was the UFO phenomenon, and people could not make that connection until decades and decades and decades into seeing UFOs. And then they began to realize that there were people inside those UFOs, aliens, and they were here for a reason. They weren't here to just learn about us or to collect flora and fauna, as a lot of people thought for many years. They were here for a reason.
Got it. Let's go to Joe very quickly. Joe, you there?
Yes. Yes. Hi. Art, Professor. Hi. Second time caller, Joe, San Diego County.
Okay.
Talking about the procreation, going back to how you're saying that these aliens procreated, that harkens back to the Middle Ages, about the 17th century, when the witch burnings and the huntings, Reverend Montague Summers and the Malleus Maleficarum, stated that demons would come first as a woman to seduce a human male, and the semen would be used to not only fertilize for the demon, but then the leftover would, she would transform into an incubus and therefore would seduce a woman again. And each time there would be DNA from the demons mixed in with the humans and passed on. And so it sounds so similar that maybe they've been doing this since the 17th century. Could that be possible?
Probably not. And the reason is because we would probably know about it in some way, in people's diaries, in stories written, in other ways that we would be able to keep track of it. But in fact, now there's a huge flaw in what I'm saying, because in the 1920s, we know what's happening in the 1920s and the 1930s, and nobody said anything. So that may be wrong. But at the same time, we have been able to trace it back to the last quarter of the 19th century. And after that, we completely lose sight of it. And we also lose sight of airships. For example, in 1896 and 1897, there was a mystery airship wave, which was very strange indeed. A lot of people think it was folklore, but it didn't seem like folklore. Then in 1909, there were airship waves in the New England area. Then there was really not much that people reported, that's a critical event, until World War II. And then there was the Foo Fighters in World War II, and right after there was the Ghost Rockets in 1946, and then the major waves of UFO sightings that people began to report in 1947. So there is a sort of trail that we can go through looking at this thing. But when you get past the mid-19th century, let's just say, it really drops off the cliff. And you're going to get similarities here and there in literature and in art and this and that. But you can't put a whole lot of trust in those.
All right. Joe and Professor, hold on for a second. Lance says this, Art. This is the only coherent explanation of the whole alien visitation business that I've ever heard. The pieces have always been there, but Dr. Jacobs has connected the dots. If that's true, I'm scared too. Is that how you feel, Joe?
No, actually, because, I don't feel scared. I don't feel like inciting panic or anything, but I feel this has been going on for a lot longer than, you know.
And it doesn't scare you? It doesn't scare you?
You know, I'm not going to live my life like that. I'm a cancer survivor, man. I am.
No, you got to live your life. I'm with you there.
I'm living my life, but I'm not going to be scared of that until I am face to face.
Well, you know, okay, Joe, but you may be face to face and not even know it. Right, doctor?
If you asked me that just a few years back, I would have said, no, you're not right at all. But now I have to say, yeah, you're right.
It's going to take me a while. You know, we're coming toward the end of the show. We're not there yet, but close. I've got to digest all of this, Professor, and then I think we've got to do another program. Are you up for that?
Not tonight.
No, not tonight.
I know.
Not tonight. But I mean...
Sure, if you want, though. I'm going to... there's only so much I know about the subject. So
yeah, but this is not the kind of thing you can just sort of lay on the table and leave it there. You just can't.
Whatever you want me, I'm yours.
All right, thank you very much. Here's Dale. Hi, Dale. Hello, Dale. Going once. Going twice. Poor Dale didn't make it. Let's try... Nick. Hello, Nick.
Hi, this is Nick from California. I was wondering, if you know they're coming on such a regular basis, why don't you put cameras up in your house?
It was the first thing I thought of back in the 80s.
Really?
Yeah. I put, this is in the videotape days, and I put video cameras mounted on a videotape recorder at the slowest speed possible so that we could get 8 hours and it would be pointed at a person in her bedroom, let's just say. She would then look at the tapes afterwards and see which one she wanted to send me. There might be something embarrassing she could elect not to do that and so forth, you know. And I did that with another person. I think I had about 12 people sleeping on their cameras at one point. What we got was a person getting up in the middle of the night, walking over to the camera, the VCR, and turning it off. What we got was a person getting up in the middle of the night and walking into another room, followed by an abduction. Or we got, you know, they're not going to come tonight. I know they're not going to come tonight. I'm just not going to turn that machine on, followed by an abduction. So at the same time, we did get, for example, I have one of a huge flash in the person's bedroom in the middle of the night, which wakes her up, and then she goes right back to sleep. Now, I don't know what that was. Maybe it was a plane crash across the street. I don't know. But it was an odd flash. And then I have a long sequence where a woman goes up. This is a long story, so I won't tell it, but it goes up and her two kids were sleeping in her bed. She takes one kid out and puts it in the bedroom. She comes back and she takes the other kid out, puts it in the kid's bedroom. Then she I'm trying to collapse this.
Yeah, it's not going to collapse enough unless you can really hurry.
She eventually walks out of the room. and then suddenly she's back in bed asleep. And the question is, how did she turn that VCR on and be back in bed asleep? Because it would show her moving her hand back and then walking into bed and putting the covers over her.
All right. Professor, as I mentioned, I've got to digest this and come back to you. And we've got to do another program. But you've got to admit, you've laid a lot on me and everybody to think about. Ay-yi-yi. Professor,
I'm sorry about that.
That's all right. Splutter, thank you for being here tonight, Professor, and we'll be in contact very shortly.
Thanks, Art. I appreciate it.
Take care. Holy mackerel. Now, that's a way to top off this day, huh? Been a difficult couple of days, in more ways than one. You all have a good night, or try to anyway, and sleep tight.
We got Pomona in the build. Talk about the aliens, the government we tripped. Talk about the flying saucers seeing from the building. Higher than I'm feeling, they look rather appealing.